Greetings and welcome to the introduction to astronomy. In this video, we are going to work through the part of the solar observations project. And in this case, we're going to look at the graphing portion. So how to get the graph set up to be able to complete that project. Now, some of this information you will find duplicated from the previous video on showing how to do the calculations, because a lot of this carries over. But I will specifically specify how I would like you to do the graphs and how I would like all of that set up when you submit your final project coming up shortly. So getting started here, you've hopefully seen a lot of this information before. What are the requirements? Well, you need to use this data that I provide. Which data? Well, there are data provided for the spring, summer, and fall terms. You need to select the one that is appropriate for your term. You do not need to use all of them. You only need to use that set of data. And then you should go through and complete the calculation data table as I showed in the previous video. The graphs that we're going to look at today must show both sets of data. That means my data that I provide here and your data, your observations that you made when you make your final submission. Again, optionally, you may submit these calculations and graphs to the ungraded Dropbox. That way I can give you feedback, I can give you suggestions, and let you know if there's any issues so that you can make corrections before you're submitting the final project. However, that is completely optional. If you are comfortable with it, you are welcome to just go ahead and submit the project. But this gives you a chance to make sure that before you submit it, that you know you've done the calculations correctly and that you know that your graphs are correct. So the data table, you might see something like this. And last time we filled in the first couple here. I've entered the numbers here that we calculated in the previous video. So there they are. That's what you would have gotten for these columns. Make sure that you're getting those. What we're going to graph, we're going to make two graphs. We're going to graph the declination, which is the next to the last column. So we're going to graph the declination, and we're going to graph the change in declination. So declination given by the Greek letter delta there, and the change in declination. So we're going to graph these two columns, and we're going to set up two separate graphs. So we're going to do one graph for this column and a second graph for this column. On each of those two graphs, you're going to do all of my data, and then you're going to add your data points in where they happen to fall in between. So let's set up the declination graph first. I provide graph paper like this. It is not required that you use the graph paper that I provide. You can do these graphs in Excel or another program as long as you can meet all the requirements. So I'm going to show you on this graph paper. If you're more comfortable doing it through another method, that is fine, but you do need to include everything and include it properly in the final submission. So the first thing we want to do is set up the scales for the graph, and I'm going to give you exactly what I would like you to use here. For the declination, you want to start at negative 25 degrees right at the very bottom here. So that would be negative 25. Each of these blocks is 5, so this would be negative 20 degrees, negative 15 degrees, negative 10 degrees, and so on up to the top. And if you keep continuing up here, you will find that you'll end up with 25 degrees at the top. So everything you could possibly get for any of my observations will fit within that scale. For the time scale, you want to use the time that was in the previous chart. So we started with August the 24th in that one. So this would be 8:24 at week 0. Week 1 is 8:31, 9:07, and so on. You want to mark all of those in until you get down to the final one in December. And that should be the 7th, December 7th. So you want to make sure you fill all of those in. Now, that will cover the entire range of the semester. You will not have made any observations before the 24th of August, because generally we do not meet before that time, so you won't have started the project. The project will generally be due before the 7th of December, so you will not make any observations after that time. So this will include the entire semester. And what you all you need to do now is plot the points from my data as to exactly what you got. So if you remember, the first data point was 11 degrees. So your first data point would be right there, just a little above the 10 mark. The second data point was about 8.5, so somewhere in there. And you're going to keep doing that for my points. Over the course of the fall semester, you should see a nice steady decline in them, down approaching minus 23 as we get towards the end of the semester. So you should see a very nice smooth change in the declination for my points. Now, you're also going to want to add in your points. So let's look at what you'll want, how you'll want to do that. And you'll want to add in your points wherever they happen to fall in between. Do not mark your first point does not go here at week zero. That is for observations made on August the 24th. Your point does not go here on 8/31 unless you happen to make an observation on the 31st of August. But let's say you made one on the 2nd of September. Well, this is the 31st. Then this one would be the first and this would be the second. So you would make your observation here and maybe you got something up there and you mark your point in. You may have made other observations in between and you may find yours scattered around my points. So I'd recommend when you do yours, you can connect mine with a line if you like. That's perfectly fine. Do not connect your data points. There will be much more error in your measurements. So you just want to plot yours as points, and then you can then compare them to what I have. You will want to use a different color or a different symbol to differentiate between the two sets of data. So scale set up here. The only thing I have not done yet is label that. So let's make sure we give our labels here for what we're using, and we will find that this is labeled as a declination, and it has to have units, so it's the declination in degrees. Make sure you have units on there. The time and weeks with the dates there is sufficient for the bottom, but you have to label what you are graphing on this axis. So if you leave that blank, that would be a point deduction. You'd lose a few points when you submit the final project. So that's what you'd want to do for the declination graph. Now for the change in declination graph, so let's look at how we set up the change in declination graph. Again, we need to put the labels and the units on it. So this would be change in declination, and that is degrees per day. Remember that we divided our numbers by the number of days between the observations to get an average. So you would want to start here at negative 0.5 and use each of these as being a tenth. So it'll go negative 0.4. negative 0.3, negative 0.2, and so on, all the way up. And if you keep doing that at the top, you'll end at positive 0.5. That will allow all my data to fit in there again. The date scale is going to be set up exactly the same, 8/24, 8/31, 9/7, and so on to 12/7 there. That will fit all of the data points that I give you, and it will fit anything that you made as well, should fit nicely within that time scale for most semesters. Now we will not have a data point for this first one. We will have one for August the 31st, which was that 0.364. Remember, it was negative, so it's going to be down here, and somewhere down in here we'll get our first data point. That will change a little more as you go through, so it will actually continue to increase early in the semester. So as you go a little further, you'll get data points down here, and for a few weeks it'll actually increase a little bit, and then it will start to decrease and head back up towards zero as you work your way through the semester. So something vaguely similar to that is what you would see in this case for the fall semester. Summer and spring, you'd see something a little bit different. Now, as with the other one, you do want to add your data points on this as well. So we're going to want to add your data as to where they occur on this. So you would be plotting your points that you may have made an observation here, and you got this change in declination, and you did another observation, and your change in declination was way up here, and another one that was here, and maybe one that was down here. You're going to find that the errors are significantly more with this graph than with the previous one. So there's going to be a bigger errors associated with this. So your points are going to be scattered all over the place. Again, do not connect your points with the line. You can do that with mine because you should get a nice smooth curve. That's exactly what you should have got. However, it's very easy to make even little observations. This change in declination is extremely sensitive to errors. So it will give you a big errors, even if there are just small errors in your observations. So do not worry. And in fact, some cases you'll find that they don't even fit on the graph. You might find things that are greater than 0.5 or less than negative 0.5. Don't rescale your graph. Leave the numbers that I've given you here. And just note that, for example, there was a point, but it was way off the scale down here. Or maybe there was another point that was way off the scale up here. You can note where they would have been, but you don't have to rescale the entire graph. Sometimes one very glitchy observation can throw things off and allow you to not see the actual trends in the graph that you're looking for. But you do want to plot both sets of data on the graph here, just as we did with the declination graph. So, finishing up here, again, I've said a lot of this already, so let me just summarize it briefly. I do recommend that you complete these early and get them submitted to me. Use that ungraded Dropbox. It's not limited in how many times you can submit things there. So you can submit and then make corrections and submit again. You're very welcome to make sure that all your calculations and all your graphs are perfect before you submit the project. I am perfectly fine with that. I will give you more comments. I will let you know if what you fixed is right. And I will, that way you'll know that at least when you come to the final project that your calculations and graphs are all set and ready to be submitted. Then you only have to work on the rest of the write-up portion. This will really help minimize any deductions when you get the final project, because I can tell you that your graphs, yes, your graphs are good, or no, you're missing labels, or this or that, needs to be added to them so that they will be correct. Again, you are not required to use the graph paper I provide. It is designed for this project. It fits the data perfectly. However, you can, if you're more comfortable graphing in Excel or in some other program, you are more than welcome to use that as well. But you do have to include both sets of data on the same graphs as well. And you do have to include all of the data and have everything labeled properly. So as long as you're comfortable doing that, it is perfectly fine. So that concludes this video going through the sample graphs, doing the graphs for the solar observation project. So until next time. Have a great day, everyone, and I will see you in class.